Joining me now from Halifax is General Petr Pavel. He is the chairman of the NATO Military Committee. General Pavel, I'm very glad you were able to join us. I want to ask you first, of course, that you know that President-elect Trump has often portrayed NATO as some kind of protection racket. Nobody comes to your defense unless you pay and pay more. He's called NATO obsolete. He said he'd have no problem telling those who don't pay enough, well, congratulations, you'll be defending yourself. That's a quote. All of this surely undermines the whole idea of a mutual defense alliance. Is NATO going to now pretend that Trump just didn't mean it?
Good afternoon, Terry. It's good to be here in Canada and Halifax. I believe we have to clearly distinguish what has been said during the election campaign and what will follow after it. And at this stage, I would suggest that we have to demonstrate some patience and calm to wait for a new administration and especially for new policies to be articulated clearly for us to react. At this point, I would say it's premature.
If you're right, let's say you're right, and Mr. Trump didn't really mean it, he's going to jettison his campaign rhetoric, then I want to ask you about the immediate challenge. What I'm getting at is that Russia has already seized Crimea. It is testing NATO's resolve in eastern Ukraine and in eastern Europe. Putin is building up forces around the Baltic states. The foreign minister of Lithuania, a NATO member, of course, says that he's, quote, very afraid. Does NATO now, I mean during the transition in Washington now, have the resolve and the resources to send a message to Moscow that is clear that the Baltic states will be defended, even if they don't pay enough for NATO?
I believe that the NATO treaty is a binding document for all the members. And Article 5 clearly says that attack on one is attack on all, and that we all come to assist the attacked member. In that sense, it doesn't specify to what extent ally contributes or doesn't. We all know that there are some difficulties with burden sharing, and these issues are being addressed much earlier than the presidential campaign in the United States started. We know that in Wales, heads of states took a commitment in the defense spending pledge, that they have turned in many countries the curve of defense spending upwards, and this trend continues. So I think we are on a positive track, and in relation to Russia, we are doing what has been agreed in Wales and subsequently in Warsaw, that is to strengthen our deterrence and defense, and at the same time to show the will for constructive dialogue with Russia. And we are following these decisions quite clearly.
Now, as you know, the NATO Secretary General Jens Stoltenberg has now spoken to Mr. Trump, and he said that he's confident that President Trump will maintain U.S. leadership in NATO. Can I put it to you, though, that he kind of has to say that, but both of his predecessors, Mr. Rasmussen, Mr. Schäfer, sound a whole lot less confident. They are now calling for an emergency summit as soon as Trump is sworn in to reassure the NATO allies that Trump, well, didn't mean what he said in the campaign. These are two leaders who ran NATO. Clearly, they would not be out to resolve the uncertainty if there were no uncertainty. It exists, does it not?
You know, I believe that once all of this excitement comes down and we come to the table to really discuss the situation, that we all realize that NATO is not only more relevant than it was, let's say, a decade ago, but it is still based on the same principles and values. And it is as important to the United States and Canada as it is to European allies. So in that sense, we will come back to pragmatic issues and leave away all excitements. And in terms of defense spending, we will have the discussion. In terms of Russia, we will have discussion. I wouldn't call it emergency summit, because this summit has been planned already in Warsaw. And it was meant as a summit, first summit to meet new American president and to discuss the progress from Warsaw.
Let's stay for a moment with the subject of burden sharing, as you call it. Secretary General Stoltenberg has also emphasized in his statement today that he agrees with Mr. Trump, as you do, that the NATO allies must pay the full 2% of GDP for defense. Right now, though, only five of the allies do. The U.S., of course, pays most of the bills, but I have only Britain, Greece, Estonia, and Poland, the only ones, other ones, to meet the 2%. Canada's way behind at 1% of GDP, as you know. My question is, President Obama also called on the allies to pay more, and nothing happened, nothing changed. Why would it be any different under President Trump?
Well, I don't see that President-elect would probably bring more urgency to other heads of states. But it is the situation that brings this urgency. And we all see that we have to fill the gaps. We have to increase our ability to deter and defend if necessary. And we are well aware where our gaps are. And we have to focus on filling these gaps and keep the edge in our military capabilities. And that, of course, brings the cost. And in that sense, what is important is not just to meet the criteria of 2% of GDP, but we also have a look at what real capabilities we are delivering. And in that sense, for example, Canada, even though their defense expenditures are slightly above 1%, is delivering many capabilities and is taking lead in many NATO activities. So I think we have to take a comprehensive look at the figures as well as real capabilities.
One final question. You have said, obviously, you believe in this interview and elsewhere that NATO remains relevant and resolved and capable, but I must put it to you that in Crimea we have very recently lived through what is surely the first seizure of territory by force in Europe since the Second World War. And I grant you that Ukraine's not in NATO right now, but has Vladimir Putin not proved that he can indeed push into Eastern Europe and nobody will stop him?
I think there is a big difference. As you said, Ukraine is not a part of NATO, and as such, it is not covered by Article 5. We can only do what we are doing, that means to assist Ukraine at many levels to increase their defense capabilities to deal with the situation, to support Ukraine both militarily, economically, and politically. But we cannot come to her defense. In relation to NATO, it is obviously different because it has been stated many times that Article 5 is valid, that NATO allies stay in solidarity. And I think we have expressed that solidarity clearly in bringing together this forward presence that is based on many NATO allies standing together, demonstrating clear resolve to face any threat coming from Russia or from anyone who would threaten our population or territory.
General Pavel, I know you have a busy schedule at the conference and summit, and you've been very generous with your time. That's General Petr Pavel, the chairman of the NATO Military Committee. Thanks for this.
Thank you, Terry.